Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Gift of Adult ADD, How to Transform Your Challenges and Build on Your Strengths by Lara Honos-Webb, PhD, narrated by Holly Adams. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type The Gift of Adult ADD into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code FOCUS, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. A radio show host once described my first book, The Gift of ADHD, as applying the principles of the runaway bestseller, The Secret. While I am a fan of the basic ideas in The Secret, I felt defensive enough to explain that my book was published before The Secret. As a well-trained psychologist, I was afraid that my approach, applying clinical observation, sound theory, and established research on the power of self-fulfilling prophecies and optimism to understanding ADHD and ADD, would be trivialized as a spin-off of a popular fad. But I am struck by one important lesson that can be derived from The Secret's Law of Attraction. According to the Law of Attraction, what you see in the present is created by the past. If you define reality by what you see in the present, you create a future that will be no different. If you want a different future, you have to change your perception of what you actually see now. This simple idea addresses one of the biggest challenges of applying the ideas detailed in The Gift of ADHD and The Gift of Adult ADD. Sometimes people with ADHD or ADD have such out-of-control symptoms that they don't believe any gifts are present. To recognize and understand these gifts, you must first suspend your disbelief. You may look around you and see relationships difficulties, professional failures, and a trail of catastrophic mistakes caused by sloppiness. It is here that you must embrace the idea that what you're presently seeing is created in part by not seeing the gifts. Finding and focusing on the gifts will create a different future for you. So if you're tempted to doubt, remember, changing the way you see yourself will change you and your life. Don't allow yourself to be distracted or derailed by what you see around you now. ADD and ADHD. You may be wondering what ADD is and how it differs from ADHD. ADD stands for Attention Deficit Disorder, ADHD for Attention Deficit / Hyperactivity Disorder. In my previous books, I used ADHD because that is the precise diagnostic term presently used in the Bible of the field, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. Not only is ADD not, as of 2007, listed in this manual, the current system defines ADHD as a developmental disorder and does not presently include criteria for diagnosing adults. The most authoritative method for diagnosing adult ADD is covered in Chapter 1. In this book, I've chosen to use ADD rather than ADHD because the hyperactivity component tends to be less troublesome for adults than it is for kids. Also, the term ADD is more widely used in the lay world and thus more recognizable. It's also less of a mouthful to say and read. Flexible thinking. As you listen to this book, I challenge you to practice flexible thinking. If an idea presented contradicts something you've heard elsewhere, rather than rigidly arguing about which viewpoint must be the correct one, ask yourself, is there a way both of these could be true? For example, this book invites you to think optimistically about who you are and what you are capable of. You may at times resist this invitation, worrying that if you think only of the positive, you won't take responsibility for impulsive behaviors. ask yourself, is there a way I can reframe my impulsiveness and still take responsibility for my behavior? Push yourself to find ways to think in terms of both and rather than either or. Similarly, when you hear that you need to find a career that honors your ADD style, you may think, are you telling me I need to lower my standards? No. Again, push yourself to find ways that you can both honor your ADD and raise your standards. There is no reason you can't do both. In practice, as you stop trying to cram yourself into a mold that doesn't work for you, you'll move from simply fulfilling performance demands toward becoming a genius in your area of interest. How to use this book. Each chapter of this book contains one or more activities to help you learn more about yourself and apply the book's ideas to your life. Since you have ADD, you will be tempted to skip over these. That's fine, but if you want to make actual changes in your life, know that these activities will pay off. Consider buying yourself a special journal to use as you go through the book, both to work through these activities and to write your thoughts and ideas in. Each chapter also includes an inspirational story of someone who has achieved success, not just in spite of, but because of having ADD. Individuals profiled include Kimberly McCoy, a psychotherapist, Steve Goodchild, a successful businessman, Scott Ulrich, a fire captain, Paul Orfila, the founder of Kinko's, Bill Jacobs Jr., a successful business owner, Damon Harper, a physical trainer and coach, Hagen, another successful entrepreneur, and Stephanie Moulton Sarkis, a writer and psychologist. I've also included the stories of Mike, a student of mine, and Vishnu, a client. I didn't record these interviews, but have included some recreations of our conversations to give you a flavor of the live-action ADD style, often wildly tangential and impulse-driven. If you ever need a boost, revisit the profiles of these amazing, real people. How this book is laid out. In Chapter 1, we will review the specific symptoms of adult ADD. You will learn that while you may have ADD, you are much more than your ADD. While acknowledging the dark side of an ADD diagnosis, this chapter will begin to paint a picture for you of the bright side of ADD. Chapter 2 will help you recognize that the most important thing you can do to cope with your ADD is to find the right environment, one that matches your profile of gifts and weaknesses. You will also learn that you don't have to do everything well. Rather, you really only have to be good at one thing. In Chapter 3, we will use the metaphor of lifting weights to help you gain the necessary skills to pay attention to details, listen to others, and complete projects. Intimate relationships and parenting can often become intense struggles for adults with ADD. Chapter 4 will offer some guidance on these issues. Guidance will include inspiration and activities to help ADD adults find mystery and therefore vitality in committed relationships and gain skills for navigating intimacy. Chapter 5 will reframe the typical ADD symptoms of impulsiveness, focusing difficulty, and non-compliant behavior as creativity. For example, the ADD tendencies toward being spacey and daydreaming will be shown to promote fortuitous insight, imagination, daring originality, and intuition. Nature can provide adults with ADD the calming influence they need. In Chapter 6, we will explore vivid case studies that show the importance of connecting to nature. This chapter will also provide reassurance and positive validation for those who fear their constant need for activity and unquenchable desire to connect with nature are simply distractions rather than personal needs and style. Chapter 7 will review the interpersonal gifts of adults diagnosed with ADD. This chapter will also provide guidance for translating inappropriate or impulsive behavior into productive contributions. Activities will be provided for channeling the interpersonal gifts of ADD in socially skilled ways to enhance relationships. In Chapter 8, we will reframe the ADD symptom of hyperactivity as a surplus of energy. You will be guided to view your surplus energy as a valuable resource. This chapter also includes awareness exercises for appreciating your energy and action strategies for channeling your energy. Chapter 9 will help you understand your lack of emotional control as a capacity for emotional sensitivity and expression. Specific exercises will teach you both self-soothing techniques and how to appreciate the value of clear and intense emotional experiences. And finally, in Chapter 10, we will review the pitfalls that many adults with ADD fall into. We will also explore the promise of ADD through the successful transformation of a client who applied the principles in this book. It's time to direct your abundant energy towards your personal transformation. I'm excited for you. You're embarking on a journey that can turn your life around. Part 1. Getting Ready to Rumble. Chapter 1. Is it just me, or is the whole world ADD? Go for it. And while you're at it, stop and smell the roses. This is the mixed message of our culture. The problem is, stopping and smelling the roses can be a thorny business for ADD adults. I have ADD and I can't play Candyland with my kids because I can't sit still for a game meant to stimulate the mind of a 4-year-old. That's the curse of ADD. We love to go for it, but can't turn off the very motor that is always going for it. Fire, ready, aim. That's the credo for many who live with ADD. ADD does not have you. This book will both show you the gifts of your ADD and teach you how to turn off the motor. Part of the revolution is to find and focus on what you already do well and not worry so much about patching up weaknesses. The other part of the revolution is that you have ADD. ADD does not have you. This book will help you find the blessings in ADD and give you the power to make choices when confronted by ADD's dark side, feeling driven, distracted, and constantly derailed. The key is self-efficacy. Self-efficacy is the power you have to act on your life and affect outcomes. In self-help terms, this is intention. In this case, living with intention means that although you recognize that your ADD is real, you choose to live a full life, and you set the course for what a full life means. Once you're aware of exactly how ADD limits your life, you can begin to make different choices. You can set the intention to not be ruled by your ADD, and instead allow other parts of yourself to have a say in directing your life. The dark side of the gift. Although scientists and clinicians are still debating the best way to diagnose and treat ADD/ADHD, the disorder is recognized as a valid neurobiological condition that causes significant impairment in those whom it afflicts. As I wrote in The Gift of ADHD, the label ADD adds insult to injury. It reminds me of a scene from the movie Monty Python and the Holy Grail. When the Black Knight's arm is cut off by King Arthur, he proclaims, "'Tis but a scratch." Then his other arm is cut off too. "'Barely a flesh wound," he says. The joke is his bravado in the face of one mortal wound after another. The resilience required to maintain dignity in the face of ADD labels such as deficit, disorder, impairment, irreversible brain damage, and affliction is no joke. It's self-evident that a deficit disorder causes impairment. Indeed, impairment in functioning is required to diagnose ADD in an adult. What is less evident, but equally important, is that in many ways ADD is a gift. This book will focus on both giving you more choices in response to your symptoms and seeing some of those symptoms as strengths that others do not have. I don't argue with the idea that ADD is a neurobiological condition. The evidence that ADD is genetic is compelling. If so, it makes sense that our actual brain structure is involved. ADD may be hardwired into us, but it may also be adaptive and provide us with advantages others lack, particularly in our current fast-paced digital culture. Diagnostic criteria for adult ADD. The symptoms of ADD are real and debilitating. They can be clustered into three categories: difficulty concentrating, feeling driven by a motor, impulsiveness. Many ADD experts have argued that these symptoms are all caused by a failure of executive functioning. Whereas most people have a little general or an inner CEO in them that directs, controls, and organizes their lives, people with ADD are driven instead by impulses, whims, and emotions. Adult ADD is a relatively new phenomenon, and as such, hasn't yet made it into the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the formal diagnostic manual for psychologists and psychiatrists. Leading ADD experts Russell Barkley, Kevin Murphy, and Mary Ellen Fisher have found that people with adult ADD can often be described as follows: distracted easily by unimportant stimuli, impulsive in decision-making, as if driven by a motor and have difficulty stopping when involved in a task, prone to jump into a project without following directions, likely to forget about promises and commitments, likely to mix up the order and sequence of well-defined tasks, likely to drive their cars too fast, likely to struggle with paying attention in work and recreation, disorganized. For diagnosis, these symptoms, except for obvious reasons excessive speeding, must have been present before age 7. In addition, the adult must show an impairment in functioning. A diagnosis requires 6 of the 9 symptoms. Diagnosing ADD. Because most people have some of these symptoms some of the time, ADD is often misdiagnosed. Researchers and clinicians alike have noted intense complications and pressure in making a diagnosis of ADD. The pressure to diagnose ADD has been described by physician Larry Diller as coinciding with when drug companies gained permission to advertise directly to patients in the mass media. Because so many people recognize symptoms of ADD in themselves, they may go to the doctor with a self-diagnosis, often a misdiagnosis. If you think you have ADD, you'll need to be thoroughly evaluated by a psychologist or a psychiatrist to confirm the diagnosis. This evaluation should include a medical exam to rule out health problems, as well as a lengthy interview about your work and family history. A diagnosis should also involve documentation to confirm that symptoms were present before the age of 7. This could include parents' accounts or school reports from that time. If symptoms began during adulthood, they're likely to be related to other stressors, health problems, or diagnoses. Be wary of any professional who tells you to try medications in order to confirm a diagnosis of ADD. Because they are universal performance enhancers, ADD medications can work for many adults who don't have ADD. Seeing problems as strengths. While the gifts of ADD, which I'll discuss at length in this book, are real, so are the pitfalls. Adults with ADD have higher rates of divorce, job changes, and drug and alcohol use than the average adult population. But the focus of this book isn't on amplifying and explaining the pitfalls of ADD. Almost every other ADD book and expert out there has comprehensively documented these pitfalls. These books reflect the very real anguish often experienced by people who go through the world driven by passions, inner promptings, and unknown biddings. While it's important not to glamorize the gifts of ADD, an extreme focus on the problems of ADD can also take its toll. I have worked with suicidal clients driven to despair by the unrelenting punishments of an environment focused excessively, harshly, and rigidly on what they could not do, rather than on what they could do. By focusing on the gifts of ADD, I don't mean to gloss over the problems associated with ADD, Rather, I want to give you more choices in the face of these problems. Changing your thinking to change your life. Cognitive Behavioral Therapy, CBT, a widely used and very effective form of therapy, can help you change your thoughts about yourself and the life challenges you face. CBT therapists help you focus on the positive, widening your perspective to allow you to see that any challenge can also be an opportunity. That is the function of this book. It is a therapeutic reframing of the negatives of ADD as positives. The way out of despair and shame is to find what you do well and focus on that. By building your life around strengths rather than patched-up weaknesses, you can help your greatest gifts find expression. The Bright Side of the Curse. Hilarious! If I had to choose one word to sum up the gifts of ADD adults, hilarious would be it. ADD adults are often wildly inappropriate and irreverent. They can be the funniest, most interesting people we know. While many of us struggle with shyness, people with ADD are uninhibited, the loose cannons in the crowd. Many ADD adults were once class clowns. Hilarity separates itself from run-of-the-mill funniness in its unbelievable quality. Sometimes the adventures of ADD adults and even their serious efforts are hilarious. For a person punching a time card, the various ways ADD adults fill up their time and nurse their creative energies are often unbelievable. We may watch and wonder, is this for real? Hilarious or Gifted, an ADD story. A businessman with ADD is running a meeting. A colleague is poised to begin her PowerPoint presentation. He has no patience for PowerPoint presentations and asks her to just talk instead. She stammers. He asks her to just start a conversation. She does, but within minutes he has somehow derailed the discussion and is asking her, "Haven't you ever had peanut butter stuck to the top of your mouth when you were stoned?" While this may be hilarious, it may also cause you to wonder, where is the gift in that? Well, if you're Paul Orfila, the founder of Kinko's, who happens to be the businessman of this story, the gift lies in the ability to go beyond business blabber to get straight to personal connections, an ability that helped him build Kinko's into a business he then sold for $2.4 billion. He is legendary for the prowess of his business mind. While attending a dinner party to gather stories about Paul for this book, I casually chatted with some of Paul's friends. One of these friends told me that one of his good friends, a high-level executive at Starbucks, emphatically declares that Paul Orfila is the smartest businessman he has ever met. The Gifts of ADD. Since writing The Gift of ADHD, I have been contacted by droves of adults with ADD. I'm always struck by their energy, the apparent inappropriateness of their behavior, their resilience, their grandiose ideas, and how very flat my world looks when compared to the ones they've painted for me. These magnificent adults have tested my capacity to set limits, piqued my interest, and sparked my sense of humor in ways that I could never have imagined. I've come to see that ADD adults not only build castles in the sky, they build many castles in the sky and somehow juggle all of them at the same time. This precarious, daring, amazing, and highly entertaining behavior often makes me wonder, how do they do it? As people from all over the world contacted me, I began to feel like there was an underground renaissance occurring. These adults with ADD had minds like Da Vinci and Michelangelo, minds that synthesized information from many domains, minds that didn't limit these adults to a single profession or identity. These were people who had chosen not to follow trends, people who had chosen instead to march to the beat of their own drum, seemingly indifferent to the approval or lack thereof of others. Find and focus on your strengths. From what I can determine, the successful CEO types in this bunch rose to their success through a combination of powerful emotional and intuitive skills and using their hyperactivity to overcome difficulties with organization and attending to details. Highly successful ADD adults have found ways to translate ADD's emotional sensitivity and impulsiveness into emotional intelligence, intuition, and boundless energy. Just as type A executives risk heart attacks and dying of stress unless they learn the basic skills of relaxation, so too do ADD executives risk failure unless they learn the basic skills of completing tasks and organization. In both cases, mastering these new skills requires discipline and training. As an adult with ADD, it's important to not only honor your whims, passions, and intuition, but also to train your capacity for attention. Sometimes this only comes with great effort and struggle. A Japanese proverb tells us, "All vision and no action is a dream, while all action and no vision is a nightmare." Just as physical health requires logging hours in the gym or on the trails, sustained effort is also required to build the muscles that will allow you to ground your visions. This book will not only help you find and focus on your strengths, it will also highlight key areas to develop, areas that, once strengthened through training, can fuel your success. Cultural considerations. A world gone ADD. For many, ever-present digital and internet technologies offer the chance to be connected globally at any or every minute. This scenario might be a nightmare for some, but it can be a dream come true for a person with ADD. This explosion of stimuli and information has created a culture that may be rewarding and thus conditioning in us traits very similar to those that signify ADD. I'll say more about this idea later in the chapter, but for now, consider the idea that in our contemporary culture, those who have the neurobiological condition that is ADD may be poised to adapt more quickly than those who do not. For those of us who struggle with ADD, the question remains, is ADD a gift or a curse? It depends. It depends on how you spend your time, how you make your living, and who you primarily share your life with. If the bulk of your time is spent staring at spreadsheets and reconciling accounts, and this isn't something you're passionate about, your ADD energy is likely to be a curse. If, on the other hand, you juggle lots of demands and must keep abreast of many different channels at once, your ADD energy may be a gift. Good news for the ADD child now grown up. Global changes may create a world that is a good match for the symptoms of ADD. The world is changing so fast that the workplace of the future will bear little resemblance to the workplace of today. As Thomas Friedman, author of the groundbreaking The World is Flat, said dryly on MSNBC's Tim Russert show, "I don't know what parents are worried about. Raising kids today is like training them for the Olympics. The only difference is they don't know which sport they'll be playing." The Industrial Revolution, which led to a culture in which a person could expect to spend a lifetime in one company or specialty, is over. We're in the digital age now, and innovation is the coin of the realm in terms of job success. The buzzwords of today are inventiveness, adaptability, and creativity, the very gifts of ADD. This is good news for the ADD child, now an adult. The defiance of an ADD child can transform into self-reliance as an adult, leading to both new ways of looking at the world and new solutions to old problems. An ADD child's impulsiveness can also be a great asset for an adult, particularly for those adults who have to synthesize information from many different disciplines and apply what they know in the real world. Similarly, an ADD child's hyperactivity can translate into the high energy required to keep up with a constant influx of information and ever-changing technologies. Even the low tolerance for boredom that got the ADD child into trouble at school can be useful as an adult. A perpetual quest for excitement can keep an adult on the leading edge of the ever-changing digital world. In fact, ADD adults may be perfectly suited to succeed in the culture emerging from technological innovation and globalization. Who you are is enough. For an adult with ADD, the key to success is to find the courage to be who you are. This means shaping your life to fit your impulsiveness, distractibility, high energy, and need for stimulation. Don't change yourself to fit a world that others have created. Rather, create your own world to be the perfect match for your strengths and weaknesses. For example, ADD people often have too many interests to fit easily into a narrow job. When you can't find a job description that fits who you are, create your own job. A theme we will return to throughout the book is that what initially appears to be a distraction will often end up being an essential component to creating your own path. Explosion of adult ADD. There's recently been an explosion of diagnosis of ADD in adults. Current estimates show that approximately 4 million adults have been diagnosed with ADD. Watching a popular TV show on investing, I wasn't at all surprised to learn that sharp financial analysts are now picking pharmaceutical companies that sell ADD medications as excellent investments, citing both the growing rates of ADD diagnosis and the Drug Enforcement Agency's categorization of ADD medications as highly addictive. In this analysis, pharmaceutical companies are creating a market with their advertising and a dependency with their product. As a result, demand is likely to increase exponentially, making for a great financial investment. I'll say more in a moment about the pros and cons of medication for adults with ADD, but there is no doubt that these analysts are on to a trend. Interestingly, psychologists and other healthcare professionals aren't making similar arguments. Indeed, some are dismissing the claims of an explosion of diagnosis, notwithstanding the dramatic increase in pharmaceutical sales to treat ADD for adults. The question remains, why are so many adults being diagnosed and treated for ADD? Remember, as of yet, there is no formal diagnostic category for adult ADD in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. One reason for the increase is that, as rates of diagnosis in children increase, many parents recognize similar symptoms in themselves and seek diagnosis and treatment. Anecdotally, many adults who have found their way to diagnosis through their kids have told me that they were able to get through school in their day because teachers were willing to let them proceed without too much fuss. There is a concern that the pressure to raise scores on standardized tests has made today's school system overly rigid, and in doing so, made school much more difficult for kids with ADD. Many parents think that in previous eras, the demands of school weren't as crippling as they are now. This may explain, in part, these late diagnoses of ADD. Anecdotally, some prescribing doctors have observed that treating a parent can dramatically impact a child's ADD symptoms. This may make doctors more likely to urge parents of ADD children to seek diagnosis themselves. The role and effect of medication in the treatment of ADD. So, if you're an adult diagnosed with ADD, should you take medication to treat it? There's no easy answer to this question. The research is absolutely clear. In both children and adults, medication can be highly effective in reducing ADD symptoms. I have witnessed startling transformations in ADD adults treated with medication. I've seen adults go from emotional to clear and focused, from scatterbrains to controlled forces to be reckoned with. However, these dramatic transformations raise deep philosophical and psychological questions. I have observed that, in some cases, as individuals become less eccentric and began to conform more to societal values, they gave up various passions. For example, on medication, they might spend less time and energy on causes such as political activism or caring for animals. In many cases, the people around these individuals were glad to see them give up their unusual interests. I find some of these changes disturbing. It is impressive to see a person transformed by medication, to see a person become like another, indeed a different, person. What is worrisome is that as these individuals become more like other people, they also seem to become less like themselves. In short, I wonder whether fitting societal expectations and ideals more neatly is necessarily an improvement. Depending on their level of ambition, people with unconventional interests and odd yearnings can be anything from endearing oddballs to unstoppable visionaries. Just as the perfectly apt phrase can be a cliché, so too can perfect social conformity be dehumanizing. To have the ring of being an original, something typically has to be a little off. The deeper philosophical questions that lie behind medications reach toward the very definition of what it means to be human. The resolution of these philosophical questions is far beyond the scope of this book. Of course, these philosophical musings don't in any way deny the mounds of data proving the effectiveness of stimulant medications in treating ADD. The fact that people go to criminal lengths to obtain these medications is also powerful proof of their effectiveness and their addictiveness. It's ironic that the most focused, disciplined, and brightest minds on the planet have spent millions, probably tens of millions of dollars, to prove what any thug on the street or Ivy League student during finals week could tell you. Ritalin, methylphenidate, and Adderall, amphetamine/dextroamphetamine, are good stuff. This is similar to studying whether alcohol could be helpful in alleviating anxiety. Of course, individuals in a study like this would benefit. Effect sizes would be large. So it is with using stimulants. Most experts agree that ADD medications are universal performance enhancers. Anyone should expect to receive benefits from taking them. Many try the medications, see that they work, and feel certain that they must then have ADD. This may explain, in part, the increase in adult ADD diagnosis, as both doctors and patients may think like this. However, the argument that stimulant medications have specific effects for people with ADD is debatable, with conflicting evidence on both sides. Regardless, this strategy of seeing if the medication works is confounded by the medication's power as a universal performance enhancer. The effectiveness of these medications also needs to be taken into account when considering the exponential increase in diagnosis of ADD in adults. Because these medications improve performance across the board, not just for individuals with ADD, it's possible that people may seek diagnosis simply to get the medications. To me, it seems deeply hypocritical that the use of steroids in professional baseball has led to a national outcry and congressional hearings, while a lifelong regimen of habit-forming stimulants is being prescribed without any public protest for over 4 million adults and 4 million children. Where have all the gifts gone? Another concern with regard to medication is that highly effective medications may derail people from following careers or callings well-suited to dreamy adults with high needs for stimulation. Others have echoed this concern. Jeff Zaslow, a journalist for the Wall Street Journal, told me that his editor wonders if medicating individuals with ADD would lead to fewer journalists in the younger generations, as journalists tend to have ADD qualities. A journalist is a person who, each week, with each new feature, becomes an expert in some completely new arena, connecting with sources in very different fields and tracking down leads with unrelenting curiosity. Many typical ADD traits lend themselves to the mental flexibility and lack of structure required by journalism. If ADD meds allow individuals with ADD to embrace other, more disciplined professions, will that lead to a gaping hole in investigative journalism? In The Gift of ADHD, I similarly pondered the effect that medicating children with ADHD might have on environmentalism. Both kids and adults with ADD tend to be drawn to nature, to feel organically connected to it. Indeed, research confirms that nature can alleviate ADD symptoms. In Chapter 6, Damon Harper reports that his intense interest in preservation of beaches and other natural settings is lessened while on ADD medications. So, although research attests to the fact that medications can indeed work, we can't ignore the potential impact of medicating ADD. While this theory is highly speculative, the gifts of ADD may include a style of consciousness that organically seeks to preserve natural resources. This connection to nature may provide the seeds of hope for staving off widespread environmental destruction. If so, medicating ADD could be disastrous for us all. Can technology create ADD? In millions of homes, restaurants, and gathering places across the world, a husband and father is present, but unreachable. He is gathering information on his BlackBerry, taking a call on his phone, or sending a text message. He is at the table, but his attention is on the technologies that keep him available, nonstop, to the various demands on his time. In many families, both parents are so absorbed. As a result, all of the members of the family experience an attention deficit, a lack of each other's full attention. The recent explosion of technology and global connections has created a world where it's easy to stay plugged in around the clock. The question is, what does being plugged in do to you? Research has found that high levels of TV viewing predict ADD in children. Some wonder, then, whether there might not be a relationship between the proliferation of new technologies and the increased rates of ADD in adults and children. Could wireless handheld devices, iPods, cell phones, and so on, actually be creating an ADD audience? The new world allows us to have instant and constant access to a steady stream of incoming information and entertainment from around the globe, quite literally in the palm of our hand. Is this technology creating a demand in us for constant stimulation? Could the powerful attractor of increasingly sophisticated and easily accessible information and entertainment be responsible for making an entire culture ADD? The primary symptom of ADD is being easily distracted by extraneous stimuli. Technology's lure of more answers to more questions can easily make it difficult to both follow through on other projects and organize your time and effort. What household hasn't been overturned by a family member spending hours, days, weeks researching a medical or legal condition on the internet? For the inquisitive mind, every medical condition, every medication, and every screening procedure is fair game for days of intensive research. Add to this difficulty in stopping activities when necessary, just two more symptoms. Perhaps difficulty sustaining attention and difficulty sequencing and prioritizing, and a technophile will meet most of the basic criteria for an ADD diagnosis. If the individual's family life and other performance demands are compromised by these symptoms, that is, if the individual suffers impairment in functioning as a result, then all of the basics required for a diagnosis will be present. It's easy to see, then, how new technologies can create ADD-like symptoms, causing adults to think they have ADD. However, true ADD is likely to be genetically hardwired. Thus, if new technologies are indeed increasing the rates of diagnosis, this must be, at least in part, due to misdiagnosis. It remains to be determined how these cultural factors and technological innovations will impact an individual's long-term capacity to pay attention, stay focused, and complete high-priority projects. Reasons for the increase in diagnosis. To sum up, some plausible reasons for the explosion of diagnosis of ADD in adults include the following. Parents of ADD children recognize similar symptoms in themselves. Effective medications that are universal performance enhancers cause adults to seek a diagnosis to obtain desirable medications. Global and technological innovations create an ADD audience or increase in misdiagnosis. Activity: I am more than my ADD. This activity is about truly recognizing that although you have ADD, your ADD doesn't have you. Simply fill in the blanks. Even though this may feel repetitious, the more you can elaborate your identity beyond ADD, the more perspective you will gain, and the more choices you'll open up for yourself. Remember that you have a completely separate personality with wishes, dreams, and quirks all your own. And although this personality interacts with your ADD, it isn't completely controlled by it. Fill in the blanks included in the bonus material. I have ADD and blank. After completing this activity, you may want to write in your journal about how your other roles and personality traits can help you cope with your ADD. Remember, it's important to both translate your symptoms into gifts and give yourself choices beyond just saying, "Oops, my ADD made me do it again." If you find this difficult, don't worry. The rest of this book will guide you toward giving yourself more choices. Chapter 2. Find your sweet spot. Now that you're an adult, you have unlimited options as to how you spend your time and energy. You can spend time with people who are like you, or with people who compensate for your weaknesses. You can work at a job that demands that you pay close attention to details, or one that doesn't. You can embrace hobbies that release your energy and feed your interests, or hobbies that challenge you to use your weaker abilities. As an adult, you have many more choices than you did as a kid. There are many different playing fields. You get to choose which ones to spend your time on. You don't have to go to school anymore. If you're an ADD adult with bad memories of your school days, be encouraged. Many experts now agree that the current education system is itself outdated and doesn't prepare students for the globally connected world we now live in. Instead, the school system still prepares kids for the work life of the Industrial Revolution era. In 2006, Time magazine did a cover story on the failings of the current education system. It started with the joke that Rip Van Winkle went to sleep for 100 years and woke up today. The only thing he recognized was the classrooms. In part because of lack of resources, and in part because of the focus on standardized measures of success, the education system hasn't moved to accommodate the dazzling technological advances of the digital age. ADD traits are a poor match for this outdated educational system. While mainstream teaching philosophy has expanded into alternate teaching techniques catering to individual styles, these developments are being put into place only recently, and with budget cutbacks, these sophisticated approaches may not be applied in many settings across the country even now. And unfortunately, as many parents and psychologists report, even in classrooms led by teachers skilled in accommodating the entire spectrum of learning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.